worship together.
Come to worship with us, and we want to greet each other, so I'll give you a minute to do that, and we'll begin our worship. I want to remind you of one thing. If you don't know where to go for your life group classes as you leave today, there are people out there that will help get you there. Now you can welcome each other.
Thank you.
Amen. Cindy and I had the opportunity this weekend to go to Poplar Bluff on Friday and twice on Saturday to attend the Bridge the Gap Conference. Pastors from all over the area and pastors from outside of the area. And I heard one resounding theme over and over again, and that is that God is bringing great awakening and revival, and it's going to start in Southeast Missouri. And I believe that with all of my heart. I believe it's coming. I believe it's going to be bigger than we've ever thought. I believe the world is ripe right now for a great awakening and a great revival. This nation has never been so wicked. This nation has never been so evil. The things of God have never been flouted like they're being flouted now. What's good is bad, and what's bad is good. And we live in a day when people have no respect at all for God's word, for God's people, and for God. And so I believe that it's ripe. You would say, well, it's too bad. It's so bad it can't happen. No, that's when it's going to happen. And I believe revival is coming. The Bible says in the last days, he'll pour out his spirit in a greater way than he ever has before. And so if you read back about the three great awakenings of the United States from the 1800s till now, and you read about those, and God did amazing things, I'm telling you, it's going to be greater than that. And I don't think it's going to start on the West Coast or the East Coast. I think it's going to start in the heartland where people love Jesus. And so I'm really excited about what God's going to do. And I'm really excited about what's coming. And yes, I do believe we are living in the last days. One day the trumpet's going to sound and we're going to go home. But I believe God wants to bring a great awakening before that so that more will come be saved and come to know Jesus. The church will get right and be what they ought to be before God. And so I am so excited about what's ahead. I realized this weekend that I've kind of lost my vision a little bit. I don't know if you remember, y'all that were here 24 years ago. You were here 24 years ago when I came. Raise your hand. Still quite a few of you. 24 years ago, the second month I was here, God laid on my heart that Minor Baptist Church would run 1,000 someday. We got pretty close a couple times, but then things started to go the other direction. And I kind of lost my vision and thought, well, maybe I heard wrong. Maybe it's not going to happen. Let me tell you, when this great revival hits, 1,000 here may not be enough. When this great revival hits, people are going to flood our churches. And we're going to find out who the real churches are, by the way. And the next series I'm going to start the week after Labor Day is the marks of a true believer. Not the marks of those who call themselves Christians. Not the marks of those who go to some liberal church where they say, well, this sin's okay and this sin's okay and that sin's okay. But the marks of a true believer. What are the marks of somebody who's truly been born again and truly is a believer? And the number one, by the way, is he loves Jesus with all of his heart. And I want to ask you this morning, do you love Jesus with all of your heart? We've been praying this summer for a revival and great awakening. We're going to continue that tonight at 6 o'clock. I'd invite you to come and be with us. We had about 30 people show up and pray for great awakening and revival last week. And I'd invite you to come and be a part of that tonight. It's coming. Get on board. Be part of it. Be excited about what God is about to do in our midst. And not just in this church, but all through this area. All through this area. It was amazing because people kept saying through the I-67 corridor, down through the I-60 corridor, and guess what? I'm not I-60, but Highway 60. We're in the middle of that. Where were they come together? And I'm just thinking God's going to do some great and mighty things. So I want you to gather with me in the front. I want us to pray for revival right now. Pray that God will come and bring great awakening to us. In the beginning of that, we're going to pray for Jeff. He's doing a lot better than he was earlier in the week. So we're going to pray for Jeff with COVID in the hospital. And we'll mention that God knows who our other requests are. But just come on down and pray with us for revival. Let's just join together and pray for revival and great awakening. It's coming. You might as well be a part of it. You might as well be a part of it. Everybody lay hands on the person in front of you, and let's not unite in that way. Father, first of all, we come and we pray for Jeff Winders. We thank you, Lord, for the progress that's been made this week, that the oxygen levels on the ventilator have been able to be turned down. But Father, we pray this week you'd set him free from that thing. And Father, that he'd rise back up and go back home. Lord, we have many others who have COVID. It's sweeping the area. It's sweeping the United States again. Father, I have to look back, and I believe with all my heart we made a mistake by closing down. because church is essential. Church is essential. We can be careful, but Lord, you are essential. And I don't plan to bow to the government again, Lord. I confess that I did that, and I don't intend to do it again. And Father, we believe that you will be with us. And Lord, I pray you'd protect all of us, that none of us would receive any of these new variants. And Father, you'd protect us and keep us well and healthy. And if anybody does get sick, Lord, that you'd rise them up immediately. And Father, we just pray for that. Now, Lord, I believe that we are living in the last days. How could it be any different with what's going on around us? God, we are in a mixed up world. The United States is fighting with itself all over the country. Parents are fighting with school boards over masks and CRT and all kinds of things. Correct pronouns, which are not correct at all because God made us either a man or a woman, a boy or a girl, and we don't get to choose which one we are. Father, that's against your word, against your will, and it's straight out of hell. And so, Father, we just pray that this country would wake up, and they'd wake up only one way. It's not going to be with a different president or a different Congress. The only way this country is going to wake up is with a move of God. And Lord, we pray there would be a great move of God. And Lord, as we pray that, I pray every person in this place would agree with me and pray and say, first of all, Lord, let it begin in me. God, we've got to get our priorities straight. God, everything else seems more important than serving you. And Lord, when we get our priorities straight, then I believe great revival will begin to happen. Great fire of revival will begin to roll. And Father, I pray that it start with me, Lord. Help me to keep my priorities straight. I know, Lord, you emptied me out this weekend. I confessed a lot of things I didn't even know I needed to confess. And Father, as we get right before you and our prayers become powerful, Lord, then we'll see great and mighty things happen. Lord, you want to bring revival. You want to bring a great awakening. You want people to turn back to you. You want people to be saved before it's too late. And Father, I believe that with all of my heart, and all you're waiting on is your people who are called by your name to humble themselves and pray and repent and turn from their wicked ways and allow you to come and move. So God, we just pray that that's exactly what had happened. Father, that our people, your people, those who are true believers, would commit themselves totally and completely to you, and you would take over and move in this nation like you never have before. In the latter days, you'll pour out your spirit, Lord, in greater ways than you ever have before. And so, Father, we looked for the things ahead to be greater than the things in the past. God, help us not to be discouraged. Help us not to be down. God, none of this has caught you by surprise, and you are in control. And we believe, Lord, the moment is ripe for the coming of great revival. Move in true believers, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise the Father. Praise the You may be seated.
I want to say to you this morning, first thing, I was reminded this weekend of how much I love you. It's been a wonderful, wonderful blessing to serve at Minor Baptist Church these years. And Cindy loves you too. And we've seen your love expressed toward us in your prayers during these days and during these last couple of years and in all the things that you've done. And I just want you to know how much I love you. And we want to serve you. We want to continue to serve you. When you start out telling somebody how much you love them, they worry the next thing's coming to the resignation. That's not coming, folks. I am renewed and revived and ready to go. And we want to serve you every way that we can. You know, we had a conversation last night, and two or three names came up that honestly, we couldn't hardly remember the names. We finally did, of people that used to be here. In these 24 years, we've seen a lot of people come and go. A lot of people come and go. Some have left for jobs in other places. Some have moved to other communities. Some have left and gone to other churches. Bottom line is, that used to really, really bother me, especially the ones that left and went to other churches. I've come to the point where I realize I need to preach what God lays on my heart, preach it with fire and preach it with enthusiasm, and if people don't like it, they can go somewhere where they don't preach it. And so that's just the way it is. And so, but that said, I wanted to say I love you first, because I do. And I don't want any of you to leave, but I do love you. I'm going to preach it the best I know how, and I'm going to stay true to the Word of God just like He told me to the day He called me to move from the youth ministry to the preaching ministry, and I'm going to continue to do that. And so I'm just excited about what's ahead. But let me say this. I believe that for this moment, for such a time as this, I believe that God has the folks in Minor Baptist Church that He wanted to have here. I believe you're here because you're called by God to be here. I believe you're here because God has a work for you to help us do. I believe you're here because we're ripe for revival, and your heart is beating with that, and you want to see revival come. You know, I've asked a lot of people over the years, and we're going to look at Apostle Paul tonight, or this morning. I've asked a lot of people through the years, you know, I've asked someone about Jesus, and do you know Jesus? And I get these kind of replies. Sometimes I get, oh, yes, I go to church at Minor Baptist. I've even had that one. Do you know Jesus? Well, yeah, I go to your church. But it may be because they only come at Christmas and Easter. I don't really know who they are. Or maybe they come a little more often than that, and I still don't know who they are. Or they might say, oh, yeah, I go to the Methodist church, or I go to this church, or I go to that church. You know, the church is a place where true believers gather, but the church is not a savior. We need to understand that. Or the second answer I get a lot, especially in our area, oh, I'm Catholic. Does that exempt you from knowing Jesus as your savior? I'm Catholic. That wasn't the question. Being Catholic will not get you to heaven any more than being Baptist will get you to heaven. It's not about what you claim to be. I remember when my cousin Rodney, who pastors here in town at another church, was asked one time when we were little, are you a Republican or a Democrat? And he said, I'm a Baptist. But the label doesn't get you to heaven. And if you think you're going to get to heaven because of the works you do in the Catholic Church, or you think you're going to get to heaven because you serve in the Baptist Church and you don't know Jesus, you're going to be rudely awakened when the trumpet sounds. You're going to be rudely awakened. You see, it's not about a religion. It's about a Savior. It's about a Savior. And I think that's one of the things the church has to get right as we move toward this time of the great outpouring of God's Spirit. And we don't use this word, but biblically, I'm your prophet. I'm your preacher. And I need to speak over you that I believe with all of my heart that this great awakening is coming. I believe we're going to see revival and experience great renewal and awakening like we've never seen in our lifetimes. I mean, why wouldn't we? Who's ever seen what's going on sexually in our lifetimes now like it is? None of us. Those of us that have lived a long time have never seen anything like this, and it's time. It's time that God comes and pulls people back to Him. Many Christians today are religious, and I say Christians with quotation marks. People that call themselves Christians are religious. But I would say to you that unless you are in love with Jesus, you are not a Christian. And if you're in love with Jesus, you want to serve Him. You want to please Him. You have a desire to be like Him. And I believe He's coming, and when He comes, it'll be for the true church. What is the true church? Again, starting second Sunday in September, I'm going to be preaching on the marks of a true believer. That's going to be probably most of the fall. That'll be the next series. And I hope you'll be here, and I hope you'll listen closely and make sure that you have the marks. You have the birthmarks of a true believer. When you are born again, God changes who you are. He puts the Holy Spirit in you. The question is, does the Holy Spirit have you? And do you serve the Lord with all your heart? Another answer I get, oh, my family's been Baptist for years, or some other denominational affiliation. Or I love this one. Well, my grandfather was a preacher. Listen, you don't get to heaven by family affiliation. You don't get there that way. You don't get to heaven because your grandpa was a preacher, your daddy was a preacher. And I got both of those in my family. I got 7 grandkids who can say my grandpa's a preacher. They call me Papa. But I got 3 kids who can say my dad was a preacher. But not a single one of those will get to heaven because I preach the gospel. In fact, I know preachers that, quote, preach the gospel that are not going to make it to heaven because they have no real relationship with Jesus Christ. And so my 3 children have given their hearts to Jesus, and they're serving Him because they love Him. And 2 of my grandchildren have already done that. And for the other 5, my daily prayer is, Lord, save them when the time's right. Let them give their hearts to You and serve You with their lives, because we don't get to heaven by family affiliation. So who's the true church? Who is the true church? Again, we're going to be studying that in the fall to see who true believers really are and how we measure up. But today I want to look at Paul, first known as Saul. And I want us to see that, like many other people that say, oh, I'm Baptist, or I'm Catholic, or I'm this, or I'm that, or I'm the other, he was extremely religious. Saul was extremely religious. When it comes to religion, he was more religious than almost anybody else. But he had no relationship with Jesus Christ. So we're going to be in the book of Acts here. If you want to turn with me in the book of Acts, we're going to start in chapter 22 in the book of Acts. And I want you to see how religious Saul was. And we're going to call him Saul some of the time, Paul some of the times. If you don't know your Bible, don't get confused. Saul was his name before he got saved, and later they called him Paul. God changed his name. So Saul and Paul are the same person, but yet they're not, because Saul was lost and without Jesus, and Paul was saved and knew Jesus. That's the difference. And so keep that in mind as I use those names interchangeably. But I want you to understand that Saul was a very, very religious man. How religious was Saul? In Philippians 3:5, he described himself as a Hebrew of Hebrews. Now, I know people get confused about that, because you hear the Jews called Israel, you hear them called Judah, you hear them called Jews, you hear them called Hebrews. Hebrews and Jews are the same thing. And at one time, it was all Israel. But then there was a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom, Judah and Israel. So that's a little confusing, but all those words, except for Judah, really mean the same group of people for most of the time. And so when he says a Hebrew of Hebrews, he means I was a Jew like no other Jew. I knew my stuff. I was steeped in Jewish religion. That's what he means by that. Paul was steeped in the religion growing up. Growing up. He was trained to know the Old Testament scriptures thoroughly. Now, don't get me wrong. There's nothing wrong with training your kids. In fact, if you're not, you're sinning. If you got children and you're a Christian, they ought to not only be in Sunday school and church, but they ought to be learning about Jesus at home. Because they're getting, you know, 6.5 days of all the stuff out of the world and the video games and the cartoons even now these days and all the shows they watch and all the other stuff. And if you're not giving them any Jesus except for an hour on Sunday morning, then they're not going to get it. They need a parent who loves them and loves the Lord enough to share with them. Paul grew up in a Jewish home, and they did love God enough to train him. And so Paul was trained to know the scriptures thoroughly as a young man. There was a riot in the temple complex at one time in Acts 22:3, and they grabbed Paul and they tried to kill him, and the Roman soldiers rescued him, put him in chains, and were going to take him off, and he said, "Don't I have the right to address my accusers?" And so they let Paul talk, and the whole speech is in there, and we'll be looking at parts of it, but in Acts 22:3, he continued, "I am a Jewish man, born in Tarsus of Cilicia, and brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and educated according to the strict view of our patriarchal law, being zealous for God, just as all of you are today." Even before his Christian conversion, he was brought up a religious Jew. Paul learned the Old Testament scripture at a very early age, like other Jewish children in the first century. He would have been immersed in the law and the prophets. And so Paul knew the scriptures. As a young man, Paul had the privilege. He had the privilege. He stood out so much that he had the privilege to become a disciple of Gamaliel. Being a disciple of him meant he sat at his feet, just like the 12 sat at the feet of Jesus. That's why we call them the 12 disciples, and then later we called them the apostles. But the bottom line is there were many Jewish teachers in the day, and they would gather students around them, and Gamaliel would get the best and the brightest students. And Paul sat at his feet. He went to school, to the school of Gamaliel. And because of that, he learned. Gamaliel was such a great teacher of Jewish tradition that he was literally nicknamed the glory of the law. And he was the first one to be called Rabban, which is a higher level than rabbi. Rabbi's teacher, Rabban, is the highest level. He was the first one to be called that in Jewish tradition. And so Paul sat at the most famous teacher, the one who knew the law better than everybody else. He sat at his feet, and he learned. Paul learned all what it meant to be a Jew, all what it meant to be a Hebrew. And Paul knew the languages of the Bible. He would have learned all the Bible languages, Hebrew in the Old Testament, Greek in the New Testament. Later, he would know it because he also had a Greek background. He was a Roman citizen. And Paul knew all the languages of the Bible, and all this early learning served him really well after he got saved, because he could quote scripture and verse over and over again to proof text what he was saying about the coming Messiah that he served. So we see that Paul learned to be religious growing up in a very, very deep way. And then we see that he was a leader in religion. Not only was he religious growing up, he became a leader in religion. Philippians chapter 3, verse 4, Paul says this, "If anyone else thinks he has grounds for confidence in the flesh, I have more." Verse 5 says, "Circumcised on the eighth day," in other words, he was a Jew, "of the nation of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin," important tribe, "a Hebrew, born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee." Paul became a part of this upper sect called Pharisees. What in the world was a Pharisee? We think of a Pharisee in a negative way when we read the New Testament, don't we? Who was it that Jesus was always fighting with? Who was it that Jesus called a brood of vipers and snakes? The Hebrews and the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And we see the Pharisees were the ones that plotted his death. And so when we think about the Pharisees, we think about them in a negative way. But let me give you a little positive stuff about who the Pharisees were. The Pharisees were part of an ancient Jewish group, and they did some important things. The word Pharisee literally means separated ones. So in a lot of ways, when they were doing the right thing, they were a lot like we're supposed to be, separated from the world, separated out to Christ. The Pharisees protected the oral tradition and wrote it down. We call it the Talmud. But the Pharisees also kept an excellent written record of the Old Testament Bible. The Old Testament was there at that point. They protected it. We can thank the Pharisees today that we have the Torah and some of the prophets in great and exact form because they protected it so faithfully. So they did some good things. So what happened to the Pharisees? What happened to the Pharisees? Something really important happened to the Pharisees. They didn't recognize the Messiah when he came. With all of their biblical knowledge, with all of their religion, they didn't recognize the Jesus, the Messiah, when he came. And instead of recognizing the Messiah, now some Pharisees did. You know there were some Pharisees that got saved in the Bible. But instead of recognizing this Messiah, they looked at this new thing that was going on, this coming Messiah that their own text had predicted all through the Bible. The Bible's a story from beginning to end, leading to Jesus and ending with Jesus. Instead of falling into line, they looked at this as a competing religion, and they attacked. And why did they attack? Because the Pharisees had become religious and powerful to the point that they lost their heart. You can become so religious, you lose your heart for God. And when you do that, you're in trouble. And they had lost their heart for God. And when God sent his son in the fullness of time to save us from our sin and to live on this earth, they attacked. They attacked. And that's why we think of them in a negative way. They didn't recognize him. Paul was with them when he was Saul. Acts 22:4. Saul says, I persecuted this way to death. They called the early believers the way. That's what they called themselves. We're following Jesus. He is the way. And they called this movement of God the way. And so Paul says, I persecuted this way to death. If you'll remember, he was standing there giving approval when the first martyr, Stephen, was stoned to death. Saul was standing there giving his approval. He was a great sinner before God because he'd become so religious that he'd lost his heart. He thought he was doing the right thing. He said, binding and putting both men and women in jail. Verse 5, as the high priest and the whole council of elders can testify about me. Paul rose to such a high position in religion that he was given the power and the mission to stamp out this new movement of Jesus that they considered a competing religion. He was so zealous and so religious that he missed the heart of the matter. Father, help us to never grow so religious that we miss the heart. And Father, it happens in all kinds of denominations. Father, I've been in churches where people are so religious, they're more worried about the budget and the bulletin and the order of the service than they are about whether Jesus shows up. Father, help us not to ever become so religious that we lose our heart for you. Lord, our religious faith should be based on our relationship with you, and it should enhance it, never get in the way. And so, Lord, help us to never get that religious. Father, religion is one of Satan's greatest tools. And there are many people right here in our own community that are blinded by their religion because their priest or their preacher says it's okay. They think it's okay, but they're blinded by religion. The largest and highest leaders in Jesus' day of the religion that was in Judah said, don't follow him, and they were wrong. Lord, let us not put our faith in religious leaders. Let us not put our faith in religion. Let us put our faith in a relationship, Lord, with you, the living and risen Savior who delivers us. from sin. Secondly, I want you to see not only was Paul educated in the Word of God, Paul knew all of that. He was very religious, but then I want us to see what happened. Because Paul reached a point, probably at about 30 years of age. We don't know exactly, but we, best estimates are he was around 30 years old. I'm glad I didn't wait till I was 30 years old to become a Christian. But about 30 years old, he was converted to Jesus Christ. He had to turn his back on everything that he'd done. Up to that point, everything that he had done had been wrong. Do you think it was easy for Paul to get converted? He had to turn his back on all of those Jewish leaders that had put all their faith in him, thinking he's probably disappointing them. But the kind of conversion Paul had, none of that mattered. He was headed to Damascus. He was going to Damascus because I guess there weren't enough people of the way to arrest in Jerusalem. And so he had orders from the high priest and the leaders to persecute and arrest Christians. And he's on the way, and on that road to Damascus, Paul's life changed drastically. Turn with me to Acts chapter 9, and let's just read the story. It's better in the Bible than I can make it, so let's just read it. Acts chapter 9, verse 1. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and requested letters from him to the synagogues in Damascus, so that he found any who belonged to the way, either men or women, he might bring them as prisoners to Jerusalem. He was going to arrest them and bring them back to Jerusalem for persecution. As he traveled and was nearing Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly flashed around him, and falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Paul, on his knees, falling off of the horse, said, "Who are you, Lord?" He said, "I'm Jesus, whom you are persecuting." He replied, "But get up and go into the city, and you'll be told what you must do." Verse 7 says, "The men who were traveling with him stood speechless, hearing sound but seeing no one. And then Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they took him by the hand, and they led him into Damascus. And he was unable to see for 3 days, and he did not eat and did not drink." After those 3 days were over, God called a man named Ananias, a believer, a man of well respected among the Jews and the other believers. And he called him to go and lay hands on Saul, Paul. Yeah, this is for free, but can you imagine being Ananias? They all knew who Saul was. They all knew he was an agent of the high priest. They'd heard already he was coming to arrest them. He arrives in Damascus, and the Lord says, "Ananias, I want you to go witness to Saul. Here's where he's at. Go see him." "Lord, are you sure? Shouldn't I hide from him, Lord? Are you sure?" I don't know if he did that or not, but I know he went. And he went, and God had told Paul that he was coming. And he laid hands on Paul, and when he did, his sight was restored. He received the Holy Spirit and was saved. Now, instead of persecuting the church, Paul was called to be an apostle, a servant of Jesus Christ, a missionary, a leader of the church. When Paul looked at his background, he even said, "I used to be the chiefest of sinners. If God can deliver me, he can deliver anybody." And that's who Paul was. But he was God's chosen man for the job. We see, secondly, not only did Paul get saved on the Damascus Road under Saul's conversion, but we see not only was converted, but he was discipled. And the one thing I see, want you to see about Paul is immediately he began to preach the gospel. Immediately. He wasn't even completely a disciple yet. He started to tell what happened to him. He started to share the story. He started to preach the gospel. Now, everybody's not called to, quote, preach the gospel. But when you get saved, immediately God's going to give you things he wants you to do. When you get saved, you should immediately begin to serve the Lord. It's part of who you are when you get saved. And sometimes we do that, and then over the years we just get kind of tired and we sit back and we say, you know, somebody else will do it. Do you love Jesus? Then you ought to be serving him. Do you love Jesus? You ought to be serving him. Simple illustration. And I'm not sure I got this right because I'm not sure how it happened last night. But there have been many times when Cindy said, you know what? It's cold in here. I need my sweater from the car. Okay, I'll sit here and drink my Coke while you go get it. I love her. So I almost always offer to go get it. Whatever I can do to serve her because I love her. You know, when she was down and couldn't walk and had to be waited on, I didn't leave and say, tough, just do the best you can. I served her because I loved her. As we continue to see God restore her, that's not changed. She can do anything she wants for herself now. She's working in the office again 2 days a week. But I still love her, so I serve her. When you fall in love with Jesus, you're going to have a desire to serve him. Now, serve him may not mean you take my place on Sunday morning. It may not mean you sing in the worship team. It might. It may not mean that you work in the nursery. It might. It may not mean that you show up and pray on Sunday night, but it might. How are you serving God? Do you really love him? If you love him, you'll serve him. Lord, help us to serve you from the moment we believe. Lord, if we are true believers, there's a desire in our heart to please you. There's a desire in our heart, Lord, to serve you. There's a desire in our heart to help others know about the glorious thing it is that we've received. Third point. First point was Paul's early life and religious life and how religious he was. The second one is his conversion. And the third one is simply this: Paul greatly used by God. Paul stayed in Tarsus for a while, being discipled, learning and growing in this new relationship with Jesus. Eventually, God spoke to Barnabas, and Barnabas left Jerusalem, and he was sent out by the Jerusalem church, and he went to Tarsus to find Paul. He said, Paul, God wants you to help me. So come with me to Antioch. And so they went to Antioch, and they began to serve the Lord at Antioch as Barnabas discipled Paul, and as he got deeper and deeper in the word. Acts 11:25 says, then he went to Tarsus to search for Paul. And when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. The whole year they met with the church and taught large numbers, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. By the way, that's not a name they gave themselves. It was a derogatory name. Those who didn't like them called them Christians, little Christs. And it was supposed to be a derogatory thing. But the church took it as a badge of honor, and it is. It's a badge of honor if you're a real Christian. We live in a day where in many circles the word Christian has a negative connotation. Those conservative Christians, how terrible they are. Well, let me tell you, I'm still proud to be one, and I'll be proud to be one until the day God calls me home. And Facebook can cancel me, and Twitter will never cancel me because I'm not on it. But whoever cancels me can cancel me all they want, but I'm going to preach the true word of God and what the word of God says, and I'm going to love it, and I'm going to preach it, and I'm going to teach it until I don't have a voice anymore. Because that's what God has called us to do. By the way, Paul did that, didn't he? Paul was beaten. He was stoned and left for dead. He was arrested and put in prison. And even from prison, he wrote letters that changed lives, and he preached to the guards around him and everybody that came to see him. He never shut up about the gospel because it was so real to him. Again, Paul was probably about 30 years old when he met Jesus on the Damascus Road. We put him somewhere around 32 when he started that first missionary journey. I want you to understand something. I'm so grateful that I was saved when I was 9 years old. I'm grateful that God called me to the ministry when I was 17 years old. And I've had those opportunities in those years. But I met a pastor last night. He said, brother, I'm 64 years old. This year, God called me to preach. And I'm pastoring a little church. 64 years old. Whatever God calls you to do, you're not too old to do it. You're never too old to be used by God. Whatever it is that he wants you to do, you are never too old to be used by God. I always said, Lord, I never want to be one of those preachers that rides it out to retirement when you get close to that. I've never wanted to be one of those. And man, what a great example I've had in Brother Ron. I mean, he's past 80. And he's still out preaching the gospel, isn't he? I mean, what a great example is that. He's not quit. He's not quit preaching. He's not quit working. He visits the nursing homes for me before they shut him out again. He does all kinds of things to help here. He's out preaching on the road. I don't want to be the kind of preacher that just kind of gives it up and rides it out until retirement so I can sit and do nothing. I have no desire to sit and do nothing. I've had a lot of people ask me lately, because I'll be 65 this month, 29th of August. I'm going to be preaching on Josiah that day. Little young guy, a boy king. That'll really make me feel old. But I'm telling you, I have no plans to retire. If you're hoping I'm going to go away and you get somebody better, you better pray harder, because I have no plans to retire at this point. When God makes the plan, I'll follow it, but I have no plans. Whatever the plan is in God's hands. And I'm just grateful to still be able to preach the Word of God. In Acts 21, we're told that a riot took place in the temple complex. And it was over Paul's presence there. And he was arrested. And he asked the Roman soldier to let him speak. And he gives this testimony. I want to read the whole thing this time. Acts 22, 24 is where we're going to start. It says, I persecuted this way to death and binding and putting both men and women in jail. Verse 5, as the high priest and the whole council of the elders can testify about me, having received letters from them, the whole council, the elders, the high priest, having received letters from them to the brothers, I was traveling to Damascus to bring those who were prisoners there to be punished in Jerusalem. And then he says, we read this earlier, so let's move on down to verse 13. Ananias came to me, and he stood by me and said, Brother Saul, regain your sight. And that very hour I looked up. And then he said, the God of our fathers has appointed you to know his will, to see the righteous one and to hear the sound of his voice, for you will be a witness for him to all people of what you have seen and heard. Now, I want you to get the gist of that phrase. You will be a witness for him to all people. Who was Paul? He was a Jew. He was a very, very religious Jew. And as a very, very religious Jew, he would have nothing to do with a Gentile. He would have nothing to do with a half-Jew. He had nothing to do with any of those. He thought the Jews were God's chosen people and everybody else didn't matter. And here Ananias is telling Paul that God has called him to be a witness for all people, not just Jews. Wow. What a heart change. For all people. And now, why delay? Get up and be baptized and wash your sins by calling on his name. After I came back to Jerusalem and was praying in the temple complex, I went into a visionary state, Paul says. He had a vision. And saw Jesus telling him, hurry, get up out of Jerusalem quickly, because they will not accept your testimony about me. But I said, Lord, they know that in synagogue after synagogue, I had those who believed in you imprisoned and beaten. And when the blood of your witness Stephen was shed, I myself was standing by there and approving, and I guarded the clothes of those who killed him. And Jesus said to him, go, because I will send you far away to the Gentiles. He listened to what Jesus said. He became the greatest missionary the world has ever known. He became a great church planter, planting Christian churches around the Roman Empire. He became a witness greater than any that we've ever known. And also, God used him to write a large portion of the New Testament. Have you ever looked and see how much of the New Testament was written by the Apostle Paul? God used him to write a large portion of the New Testament. This man, who was once full of empty religion, who was full of hatred for those that didn't agree with him. Sound familiar? Sound like our country? Never seen so much hatred in my life. Don't agree with me, I hate you. That's what we see all around us now. All around us. There's no civility. There's no let's talk about this. There's no let's disagree peaceably. I mean, just last night in Los Angeles, Antifa clashed with those who were there protesting the mask mandates to the point that somebody got stabbed and the police had to separate them. There is no middle ground anymore. There's no middle ground for a Christian anyway, but a Christian shouldn't be filled full of hate. We ought to love those who disagree with us. And this man who was once full of empty religion and hatred found an amazing relationship with Jesus that day. He was restored from empty religion to relationship and used by God. And as we close this morning, the question I want to ask you is, do you have empty religion or do you have relationship? Do you have empty religion or do you have a relationship? Is your life based on traditions and things of men and decisions of men? Or is your life based on a relationship with Jesus Christ? When Jesus broke the power of sin and death, he broke the power of the law. When he rose out of that grave, he broke the power of the law. So why do we have the Old Testament? Because it shows us what sin is. It convicts us. It convicts our hearts. But I'm telling you, it can't save you. Only Jesus can. The empty religion of Judaism, studying the Old Testament and living by the law, cannot save you. And why is that? Because you can't live by the law. You can't do it. It's impossible. It's impossible to live by the Ten Commandments. If that was all you had to obey to get to heaven, you couldn't do it. Am I right? How many of you have ever told a lie? Anybody ever told a lie? Anybody not ever told a lie? Raise your hand because you're just telling one. Right? You say, well, I've never told a bad lie. A lie is a lie, folks. A lie is a lie. How many of you have ever dishonored your mother or your father? Anybody ever done that before? Sure we have. Every one of us has. I don't care how much you love your mom and dad and how much you honor them, there have all been times when we dishonored them. And I had three wonderful kids. But I got a little dishonor once in a while. And they got the hand of discipline once in a while on the backside. We've all done it. So therefore, we're all lawbreakers. So you can't be saved by the law. Your only chance of salvation is a relationship with the living Lord Jesus Christ, who died in your place and died for your sin that you might have forgiveness. And nothing else will save you. It doesn't matter how religious you are. It doesn't matter what religious sect you follow or what denomination you follow. And that's why you can't be saved by Mormonism. You can't be saved by Jehovah's Witnesses. You can't be saved by being a Muslim. You can't be saved by anybody but Jesus. That's the only way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father, which is God, except by me. So if you think you're going to make it some other way, you're going to have a rude awakening the day you leave this life or when he comes again. There's only one way, and it's Jesus. And it's not talking about Jesus in Sunday school. It's not talking about Jesus, listening to sermons about Jesus in church. It's not singing about Jesus in church, although we need to be doing all those things as part of real worship. But it's about having a relationship with him. Do you have one? You say, well, I think I do. Well, if you don't find out before then, you'll know for sure when we get done this fall. I think I do. Let me ask you the key question. Do you love him above all else? If it's real, you'll love him. You'll love him. Do you love him more than these? Jesus asked Peter, Peter, do you love me more than these? These things? These activities? These things that I'm so tied up with in life? Do you love Jesus most of all? And most of us would say yes without hesitation. But does it show in your life? Does it show in how you spend your time? Does it show in where your money goes? Does it show? I hope it does. And if it doesn't, love him more. Ask him to increase your love. Ask him to use you in ways that you've never been used before. Folks, a great awakening is coming. I don't know about you, but I want to be part of it. I want to see God move and heaven come down. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. I love that song. And I want to see heaven come down and glory fill this place to the point that we feel the fire of God on us and he does a work that we could not have manufactured on our own. We can't manufacture that. We just need to pray for it and ask for it. Let's stand for a closing prayer and invitation time. Father, speak to our hearts today. Lord, bring your glory. Bring your fire. Bring the Holy Spirit in power to us, Lord. Lord, may we get so filled with your Spirit that we are serving you, that it's on our hearts and our minds. May we be so filled with your Spirit, Lord, that we are praying daily and constantly for others, that we are praying for that great awakening to come. And Lord, may we be so filled with your Spirit that like Isaiah, we say, Lord, here am I. Send me. Oh, Lord, put the word on our lips and on our tongues and the glory in our hearts and the love in our hearts. And may we see great and mighty things come. Lord, I pray for those that are here right now and those that are watching me on Facebook. Father, there's somebody right now that's watching and they've realized even through this that they don't really love you. Either the love has grown cold or it was never there to begin with. And whichever one that is, Lord, help them figure that out. Or they need to get to saved again or they just need to start loving you again, Lord. Give you first place again. Lord, I pray the same thing for those that are gathered right here. May we not leave this place unless we know we love Jesus above all else. Above all of the activities that come our way, above all the pressures on our lives, above all the things we watch on TV, above all the activities we're involved in for recreation. Lord, help us to love you above all else. And then, Lord, let us sort out what that means through the presence of the Holy Spirit in us. Father, speak to hearts today, and I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You come as we sing. The altar's open. If you need to talk to the Lord or pray for someone, you come as we sing.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Ask you a question. You think about it and answer to yourself. How many days did you come to the altar this week? You say, preacher, I don't know, I understand what that is. Well, let me explain it to you really quickly. I got an altar in my home. It's a big blue chair that sits by the window that I get in the mornings and read his word and read devotions and pray. That's my place of altar. How many days this week did you come to the altar? Does the week go by and you realize that you haven't been spending time with God? You haven't been praying for your family and friends? You haven't been praying for those that are sick? Do you come to the altar? And then for a believer, the altar can be hour by hour. That you don't have to go to a spot, but every time you get a text and it's an update on Jeff or somebody else, you stop and you pray. Every time God brings somebody to mind, you stop and you pray. Now, that doesn't mean you slam on your brakes in the middle of the interstate and close your eyes. You can pray while you drive. I do it frequently. Sometimes I get so excited when I'm praying while I'm driving, I got a hand up in the air and doing this, and my mouth's going, and people are driving by, and I know they think I'm nuts. You can pray anywhere, anytime. Let's sing that chorus again. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. You may be seated. One of the things you need to do when you come to that altar on that daily basis is ask for forgiveness. You know, I've been really working on that in my life recently, and I thought I was in pretty good shape. Everything that would come up, I'd ask for forgiveness and thought I had it all together pretty well. Last night, God showed me that I was judgmental. That many times I look at people with judgment rather than love. And I had to confess that. And that's one I'm going to work on hard, because I want to be a pastor who loves not only his flock, but those around me as well. I hope that's who you want to be too. Don't forget today, many of you have called and Suzanne's answered the phone and you say, well, I thought you retired. Well, she tried. We still need some help. We have a full-time secretary now, Leslie, who's doing a great job, Leslie Frazier. We have hired Diane Hull as our bookkeeper, so that's taken a lot off of the other secretary that we will need. So we're looking for a part-time secretary. Cindy's back to work 2 days most weeks, but we're looking for a part-time secretary probably 2 or 3 days a week. The committee's meeting right after life groups in room 420 to discuss that and figure out exactly what we need, and then we'll be advertising for that. But we got to get Suzanne going. I know she wants to retire, but she doesn't want to leave us in the lurch because she's a faithful, faithful servant to this church. And so pray that we get this taken care of and get it done and move forward. Jim?
We want to remind you to fill out the attendance sheet in your bulletin. Put it in the offering basket that will be passed in a few minutes. I want to remind you of our services tonight, prayer time for spiritual awakening and for a revival. You didn't say anything about summer celebration, did you? Summer celebration for the kids starts at 5 o'clock tonight. 5:30, I'm sorry. For youth, yes. That's different. We also want to remind you that we have a prayer meeting on Wednesday night. That's for the whole church, and we encourage you to be a part of that. We're going to have the ushers come and receive the offering, and we have a video at this time.
OMC stands for Organized Mass Chaos, because that's exactly what it is. The goal of the game is simple. Players attempt to complete as many tasks as possible, one at a time. Here's how you play. All players are divided into teams, and each person is given an OMC playing card. At the sound of the beginning whistle, each person goes and completes the task on that card. Tasks may require the help of friends, which can be found anywhere, or the use of specific equipment, which may be found in the center circle, which is also known as the no-fly zone. All players must follow the three rules of the game. Number one, you can't say no. If anyone asks for your help, you can't say no. You have to help them. Number two, no running through the no-fly zone. And number three, return all equipment to the no-fly zone. Once a task is completed and the equipment is returned to the no-fly zone, the task must be turned in to be counted as a point. The team with the most points at the end of the game is the winner. Playing OMC during a week of CentriKit is an experience unlike any other. But with the official OMC game kit, you can organize your own mass chaos at your next church event. The first thing to consider is your teams. At CentriKit, campers compete by grade level, so we have four big teams. You may divide your group by classes, grades, boys versus girls, families, or however you choose. At the end of the game, each team counts their total tasks completed and then divides that number by the number of players on each team. This helps keep the scoring fair. The second thing to consider is your setup. The field at camp is outlined by colorful flags that serve as stations to pick up task cards, as well as each corner of the field that serves as the base for each of the four color teams. At your event, the huge flags aren't essential, but you will want to make sure everybody knows where to turn in completed tasks for their team and where to pick up new tasks. The next thing is task cards. Because of the number of players during a week of camp, we print enough task cards to last an entire game. But with the limited number of cards in your game kit, you need to recycle cards after they are turned in. One idea is to encourage kids to turn in their cards to their leader and then grab another task from any other station around the field. And lastly, what happens if you can't play outside? The wildest part of OMC is, of course, the water balloons and shaving cream. But inside the official OMC game kit, there's an optional inside version for churches that are unable to play OMC outside. The task cards can be quickly separated by color in case of a last-minute rainstorm that causes you to move inside. As you might have guessed, there can be many variations of how to play OMC. So be sure to check out all of the instructions provided in the official OMC game kit and choose how you will play OMC based on how it will best fit your church. For more information, including special bonus edition OMC cards to add in for holidays, VBS, and more, visit centrikid.com/OMC. Organized Mass Chaos is the craziest game you'll ever play. Now you're ready to get out there and have the time of your life. Be sure to share photos of your OMC game on the CentriKit Facebook page.
All right, so next Sunday is going to be Organized Mass Chaos. Church-wide. No, not church-wide, okay? For the kids. Y'all are getting real worried. You didn't want shaving cream on your Sunday clothes, did you? We're going to be doing that next Sunday. John Vernon, who is the Organized Mass Chaos expert in the area, is going to be here to help. And since he is going to be here, he's also going to be sharing a message with us in the morning service. So he'll share with us in the morning service, and then he'll be a part of Mass Chaos. And I appreciate John coming because I'm going home during Mass Chaos. I may stick around and watch a little bit if there's a safe area where I can avoid all of that. But the kids are going to have a great time. So it's next week. Don't miss it. Anything you want to say about that, Amber? Do you need people to bring stuff or you need them to cook?
We need to bring the other stuff. We're going
to
provide meat. You guys bring everything else.
Okay, so parents of the children that are coming, the church will provide the meat. If you couldn't hear that, they're going to have hamburgers and stuff, and you need to bring the stuff to go with that. And there'll be a dinner after church before it starts. Okay, right after life groups before it starts. Be a great week. Be a great time. Also, next Sunday is the deadline for the trip to Branson. So here are they're up here on the front row. Oops, they're all over the place now. They're up here on the front row if you need one. The deadline for the trip to Branson, $100 deposit has to be in per person by next Sunday because next Monday I have to make a final reservation and give them numbers. So if you want to go, you got this week to decide. I know there's some fears about COVID and where we're at with COVID and all that kind of stuff. It is what it is. As long as they don't cancel the shows, we're probably going. They are not requiring masks at this moment in the two shows we're going to see, but they're recommending them highly. They're selling out all of their seats. There is no social distancing. So if you're worried at all, I would consider wearing a mask at the shows. I mean, it's air conditioned, it's cool, it's not a big deal. If you've ever been to the show at the Sight and Sound Theater, it's a huge crowd and they're selling out. So we have great seats. I reserved 35 seats way back when. I have to pare that down to what we actually need next Monday. So deadline is Sunday. After Sunday night, if you call Tuesday and say, I changed my mind, I want to go, I might be able to get a ticket. I might not. It might be with the group, and it might not. So please get your reservations in. It's a month from now. A month from Sunday we go. Okay? All right, anything else? Did we take the offering? Yeah, we did, didn't we? Let's stand up and be dismissed. I remember Cindy gave ours. Deacon of the Week. Don't have one up here. Hand that to Marcus and let him lead us in prayer.
Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for today. We thank you for bringing us together to worship. Lord, we recognize today that you are sovereign, that nothing happens without your okay, that you have a perfect plan in place. Lord, we just ask that you would give us wisdom as we find your will in our lives to help you complete your plan so the glory may be brought to you. Lord, help us to see the world through your eyes, to love it through your heart. Help us to sacrifice as Jesus did. Help us to give up our rights so that others may come to know you. Give us that balance, Lord, of what we need to give up to bring others to Christ. Just continue to work in our hearts so that glory may come to you. In Jesus' name, amen.